Hello, everybody. Welcome and thank you for joining us for tonight's triage for general practice. I would like to start by acknowledging the traditional custodians and people of the land on which we work. I recognize their continuing connection to land, water, and community, and pay respect to elders past, present, and emerging. I also extend that respect to any Aboriginal colleagues who may be joining us today. My name is Evelina Kozok, and with me is also Giuliani Cardoso. We are both from Practice Support Team. You probably know us very well by our voices. When you call to us, we usually pick up the phones. I would like to also welcome Karen Booth, who is our guest speaker for tonight. Karen is a registered nurse, accredited immunizer. She's primary healthcare nurse consultant. Currently, she's president of Australian Primary Healthcare Nurse Association, APNA. Karen's true passion is preventative healthcare and intervention to prevent damage to persons' health and well-being. She also strongly believes in the practice team working together for the best achievement of the results in the patient care. Welcome, Karen, and the voice to you. Thank you.
That's lovely. Thanks very much, Evelina. So, learning objectives for this evening, to give you a better understanding of the principles and importance of triage, some principles around infection control and triage, and I know most of you have been very good at infection control after the last 2 years of COVID. Triage is an important part of risk management as well, so protecting yourselves from infection, people coming in the door who are sick, but also protecting your patients, again, for infection control, but also in the management of emergencies. And we'll talk a little bit about clinical governance and why you need to have policies and procedures in your practice to help cover triage, but to support the staff that are doing triage. So if you think you've been busy the last couple of years, well, you're absolutely right. And according to the Institute of Health and Welfare in their 2019 survey, 88% in 2018-19, 88% of Australians saw a GP. And this equates to 154 million Medicare rebated services. So that's a lot of busy. And that's 21 million people being cared for in primary care. So entering into practices, being cared for in primary, in general practice settings and other primary care settings. So private allied health services in the same period, there were 24 million Medicare subsidised services and another 52 million that were claimed through private health insurance. So that's a lot of visits, and that's a high volume of people coming into frontline services in primary health care. And of course, lots of people coming in, high risk of transmission of communicable diseases, and of course, high risk of something, of an emergency happening in your waiting room. And I know that many of you have already dealt with lots of emergencies on the phone. So it's a lot, as I said, a lot of people coming through and a lot of care being given in primary care. So interesting, picture for primary healthcare settings. We're often very small businesses. So, there are a lot of practices, a large number of them are only 1 to 5 full-time equivalents, GPs, and with 1 or 2 nurses, an average of about 5 admin staff. So not huge businesses, but certainly seeing a high lot of people. And we don't have as much formal infrastructure for managing emergencies walking in the door or for the infection control activities that they have in some of the bigger centres and certainly in the hospital settings. So it's really important that we make sure we have a good understanding of how to manage those things coming in the door. Staff have a wide range of awareness and skills of managing potential emergencies as well as infection control risks. We have quite a bit of staff turnover as well. I mean, I know a lot of practices, certainly ones I've worked in, we have young front desk staff who might be university students rotating through, doing our administration work for us, supporting the regular team. So there's lots of new people coming through, new health professionals coming through. So we just need to make sure that they have a really good understanding of managing potential emergencies in our practice, infection control risks. And often these roles are shared between different types of healthcare members in the team. So clinical governance is really important. You need to look at how is this built into your practice systems. Practice needs to determine, of course, their own risk and the context of their risk. So a general practice might have a different level of risk to a physio. A dental practice where you have aerosol procedures might have a different level of risk to a podiatry practice. So you need to look at what is the context of my practice and how do I manage risk about this, around this. It's really important that all staff are trained to understand their responsibilities in managing risk, whether on the phone, people looking in the door, and infection control, and to regularly conduct risk audits in your practice. So there are checklists from, I think the College of GPs has a checklist that you can do a risk audit. Some of the work cover organisations have risk audits that you can adapt to your practice. But to look at the type of emergencies you might expect, but also infection control risks in your practice. And to look at having the College of GPs, the accreditation standards, recommend that you have an infection control coordinator. So someone in your practice that might have the responsibility for doing your risk audit, but also to do staff training, to make sure that people are trained to their level of responsibility in the practice and around safety and occupational health and safety for that person. So what is triage? And triage is part of and should be built into your clinical governance system as well. We're looking at a process that's used to provide a consistent and systematic approach to evaluate and prioritise the urgency of needs. And clinical governance, again, is about a systematic, accountable approach to a lot of the activities that you do in your practice. So we have triage as a standardised process, trained staff. Triage is not just a judgment call. So it's not someone rings up sick and you think, oh, yeah, I know them, I'll give them an appointment. You're actually looking at what is their urgent need. Triage looks at a safety and quality-based approach to determine the urgency of that person's entry into a care point in the practice. Do they need care today? Is it an urgent thing? Is it a sick child? Do I need to call an ambulance? And I think really important thing is to ensure that non-clinical staff are supported and protected through good policies, good procedures, good training, and of course, decision-making tools. So why do we triage? Primary healthcare services are often the first point of contact for most people, especially when they're unwell. And, you know, people will call you flu-like symptoms, they'll call you for emergencies like chest pain. I'm taking a lot of calls for chest pain. Seeing patients come in the door and say, how are you today? Oh, I've got chest pain. So looking at why triage, and part of that early recognition of symptoms, especially for emergencies, but also to facilitate appropriate management. And the little man in the corner down there, triage is important to stop things falling over. And we need to make sure we're managing risk appropriately. So some of that will be around risk for the patient, but also risk for the health service, patient safety, the person who's calling, who has the emergency or has the urgent condition, safety for people in the waiting room. So whether the person who has come into the waiting room has a potentially infectious disease, has a psychiatric emergency, has another some other urgent need. We need to look at triage when we're thinking about practice staff and practice safety. Triage is part of quality access to care. So we're looking at prioritising and making sure we're making the right decision and judging the sense of urgency for that patient. And of course, good triage system also helps protect the practice and the clinicians against medico-legal risk. Have I turned someone away who really should have been seen today and they've had an incident and there may be some comeback? So there are all of these very complex things that we have to think about in triage. So health practice employees, I've got a key up there, and you are key to quality and safety of any health service. All team members have an important role to play in quality and safety. Good governance practice tells us employers need to continually review and refresh their staff training. It needs to be according to their role and include personal and organisational occupational health and safety. That we need guidelines in place that are measurable and so that we know we can judge whether an encounter has been handled correctly, if the staff have managed to handle the emergency or the urgent issue to the level of expectation that we as a health service and as an employer would like, and be able to measure outcomes of quality and safety. So again, having those really good policies and procedures in place. Clinical governance for your practice, it's a management and organisational structure for continuous quality improvement. And we need to think with that mindset, because it means we're all striving to make sure things are, you know, running at their best or kept to their best. Staff turnover, I mentioned just a few minutes ago, is important, and it's likely to have higher impact on smaller services. You notice it more when you have new staff coming in. The little practice I worked in at Hurstville, hello, first of all, would have one person on in the afternoons. So making sure, and lots of smaller businesses are like that, so making sure that you've got someone who is able to manage and support an emergency, to support the clinical staff, to know when to notify the clinical staff. So that's why constant training is important. And to make sure that you have a consistent quality orientation program so that staff can't say, oh, I wasn't told, because you've included it as normal part of your systems that this person has had the right training and had support and refresher of training as well. It sets the ground rules for managing urgent conditions for the practice, for infection control, and again, it's something that you can measure. So if you do have an incident or you do need to look at reviewing processes, you've got a starting point of where you actually expected your practice to be for managing emergency. So some things to think about with triage. So red flags. Very common for people to present to the GP or to smaller medical practices with an emergency. They come with chest pain. Part of it, sometimes they're in denial about having chest pain. Oh, it's not my heart, it's probably something else. And there's, you know, I used to work a Friday afternoon, and I reckon every week for several weeks, the GP and I had a chest pain and sent someone to hospital in a triple O ambulance. So it's really common. People don't like going to hospital. They're scared at the moment of going to hospital. They're worried about getting COVID. Friday afternoon is very common. The weekend's coming to make sure they're sorted out for the weekend. Breathing difficulties. We still have some asthma presentations turn up. People with chest pain and breathing difficulties. Red flags, burns, anyone with an eye injury needs to be seen as soon as possible. Sick children, a distressed child is a red flag. Febrile, a screaming child, you would prioritise them. Mental health issues, people often ring distressed, something's happened, or someone with known mental illness who's having a crisis. And, of course, a red flag also unwell patients returning from overseas, which hopefully we've all really got built into our COVID protocols at the moment. Now, patient presentations, privacy versus urgency. We're all told, and as part of accreditation, that particularly privacy is important, and it is. We've got privacy legislation, we've got privacy standards, but it's sometimes very hard then to look at how many questions do you ask, particularly if you're sitting at the front desk, your admin person, thinking, oh, should I be too intrusive? Should I ask them? So triage, when it comes to this point, making standard book appointments are fairly easy. They're usually non-urgent. Often there's phone calls to the practice, and you can, as the admin team, can check level of urgency when people call. Online bookings, it's a bit harder. They're great time saver, but much harder to triage. And during the sort of heavier part of the COVID lockdowns, a lot of practices turned off the ability to book online because they weren't able to triage before the patient got to the door. So you can triage on the phone, you can ask, do you have respiratory symptoms? You can ask if you're unwell on the phone, much harder to do with online bookings. Walk-ins. Again, you have to have a really good system for stopping people before they walk into the practice or, you know, walking into waiting rooms as to the level of urgency for people who just come in for unbooked appointments. And, of course, we'd have on the day reserved for urgent appointments. And, again, all these are all triggers for you to ask questions about. Are you unwell today? Do you think you have something infectious? And often then they will they'll share. And of course, you're the first one, first point of contact, the first one to ask the questions, and you'll be the first ones to gauge the sense of urgency and that need for access to care. So safety and quality and protection of the patient and the team is an important part of triage. And there are also flagged indicators for those of you who are getting ready for accreditation coming. The quality standards in the fifth edition, I've mixed around probably some of the order so it fits in with my talk, but certainly clinical risk management is the process for improving quality and safety in healthcare. It helps you identify circumstances and opportunities and that put patients at risk of harm and then act to prevent and control those risks. So making sure our practice monitors and identify near misses, probably not, it's still all part of triage, but it's all part of your quality management and quality improvement. So criterion for responsive system for patient care. Our practice provides consultations to accommodate the patient's needs. Triage will help you to organise the needs for your patients. Is it a recall? Is it, a routine appointment? Or is it someone who needs to be seen on the day? Do I have to get this person into an emergency appointment? Our practice has a triage system. So again, a documented policy and procedure of how you would like your team to manage possible emergencies. And our recorded phone message advises patients to call 000 in case of an emergency. A lot of practices now have their phone system set up, so rather than just ring straight through to reception, most practices are so busy you don't get that first off straight through to reception. But the message on hold is great because it will say to you, if this is an emergency, call 000, rather than to delay if someone does have chest pain or someone is unconscious, so that they know to call 000. And of course, you know that we can give lots of help messages, the message on hold while people are waiting to make appointments to come into the practice. So flip my page over. So our practice has a triage system. Communications. So our practice manages telephone calls, telephone messages, and electronic messages from patients. So patients often will, now that with electronic messages in particular, might email the practice asking for urgent advice. So it's very important to set ground rules very early that patients can't get urgent advice through emails. And it's probably really good to actually advertise that on your practice website. Telephone calls, telephone messages. If something is urgent, before you put a person on hold, ask if this is an emergency. When the accreditors come, they'll listen for that. So they'll listen for you identifying the patient. If it's an emergency, it's very important, in case they drop off the phone, that you know who they are, date of birth, so you make sure you've got the right person, and where are you now? I've had to call a lot of ambulances for people at home where someone's run the surgery because mum's collapsed or dad's had a stroke or someone at home has got chest pain. So making sure you know where they are now. Are they at their own address? Are they with family members somewhere else? So you know exactly where to call the ambulance. Some family members, of course, will manage that themselves, but if they're distressed, you might need to do that for them. So very important to ask, and very important to ask you before you put any calls through, through to the doctor. So very important, all practice teams know how to identify a patient with an urgent medical need. And the policy for reorganising appointments accordingly. So do I have to fit this person in to see the doctor today? Do I need to do it in the next hour or do I need can I fit them in later in the day? And to know when to seek urgent assistance from a clinical team member and, you know, when to put the call through the doctor to the doctor, put a call through the nurse or to put the patient on hold and seek advice on next steps and how quickly to bring them in. And I think very importantly to know what to do when you have a full appointment system so that the admin staff know how to manage that patient and when to bring them in. All members of our practice must know how to identify patients with an urgent medical need. Oh, sorry, I've just done that. Didn't press the button hard enough. So the triage system prioritising for according to urgency. And to retain evidence of this, so if someone has called you at the practice with an emergency, make sure you document it, whether that be depending on staff access to medical records or whether that be through a formal messaging system in the practice through, I know medical director that I'm used to using has a blue bubble, that you can send that through to the doctor. There is a function in there that you can save that conversation into the patient file in case you need to come back to it later or in case you need to make reference to it later to prove that the conversation and advice has taken place. I think it's very good safeguard for urgent matters particularly for emergencies. To have triage guidelines and a flowchart available at reception, I think is also important. So we've had our reception and our training with triage training, but in an emergency or an urgent situation, sometimes you forget or you don't have time to, I'm just going to look up in this folder in the computer what the flow chart is, or someone passed me the practice manual on page 315 is the emergency flow chart. Have something, a flashcard that's available for reception. And fortunately, Central Sydney has a wonderful flowchart that Evelina will send you in the in resources after the meeting. You need to have it printed, it's lovely and colourful, has the steps, have it laminated, have it stuck where your staff can access it. And to make sure they've read it. And it's probably worthwhile building into your staff training, a little sign-off sheet that people have read the policy and procedure, they know where the flow chart is, and you have evidence of that in their your training. Signs in the waiting room are also important part of triage, prompting people. I've had people come into the waiting room who have been breathless, who they've walked in, family signed them in, and they're sitting wheezing away in the waiting room. So really important that you have signage up, whether that be as a printed sign or a lot of practices will have managing emergency contact receptionist know on your video loop in the waiting room messages. But important that you have another sort of signage to tell patients, actually tell the receptionist if you're not well, if your child is distressed. So introductory messages or on-hold messages that tell patients to call 000 is really good. The reception staff members know how to respond to an emergency. The triage guide, we've talked about the triage flowchart. It's also important that your staff know where to locate the emergency equipment. So if there's an emergency, the doctor says, get the oxygen, get the resus kit. Everybody in the practice needs to know where that's located and how to access it so that everyone's not running around going, where is it? Where is it? So this is a sign that I made up for our waiting room. I think shouting out, how emergency, we then put that up into our message loop. So we had it printed, but also on our on-screen messaging in practice. And, I think, again, prompts, particularly for distressed children. If someone, child comes in with a very high fever, is sitting quietly in the waiting room, it prompts the parents then to actually tell reception, I might need to see someone a bit quicker. So clear communication is essential. So again, formal policies around procedures and policies and procedures. It's critical for appropriate and safe triage in general practice and for other smaller practices for managing emergencies. It should underpin your clinical governance procedures around triage. Staff should be trained for when to call the clinician, when to contact them urgently, when non-clinical staff should call an ambulance. There should be some training or mentioning your policy if they're dealing with an emergency on the phone, should they just call the ambulance? And letting them know that that's okay. Having a script is helpful. So having a standard list of questions for non-clinical staff to help guide them when they're dealing with patients in an urgent situation. And it helps to, I think, standardise the information that you as a clinician and practice owner need. It also helps for people who are uncomfortable asking questions, particularly, as I said earlier, that privacy issue. Having a script for them takes, sort of separates them out from being intrusive and helps them then, as I said, go through the information that they need to help make the decision whether to bring them in or speak to the clinical team immediately. I would also add that administration staff should not give clinical advice. That is a medico-legal risk, unless you're saying to them, go to hospital. But you certainly wouldn't be offering treatment advice. I've intervened with staff telling patients, how much Panadol to give their child who's febrile. It's not the administration role. There are medico-legal risks around that if there would happen to be an adverse event. So it's probably better to advise, seek medical advice if you don't have a clinician on site, or to, if there's a clinician on site, seek medical advice from that person. So waiting room management and triage, You are, as I said, the first port of call. You're also the security guard. So it's your job to say who can come in and not come in to the practice, particularly at the moment with COVID and infectious situations. So we've got COVID doing the rounds, flu season is coming, and they're expecting not a very good flu season this year. A lot of children who haven't been exposed to influenza, so the chances of sick kids presenting will come soon. There's a gastro outbreak in Sydney at the moment. It's hit the preschools. We're seeing lots of adults who've had gastro. So there's quite a bit of circulating infectious disease out there. If you, if someone comes in with an infection, then of course that puts the staff at risk and other people in the waiting room at risk. So it's really good, and probably also really good to have on your website and your on hold messaging, to educate patients to tell the reception staff if they think they have an infection. Questions that receptionists could ask are, do you have a fever? Do you have a rash? Do you have a cough? Do you have diarrhea? And often you'll get public health messages coming from New South Wales Health. You'll get them coming through the PHN, so you'll know when there is an outbreak of something, something close to you. We had quite a while ago now, when I worked in a practice, the parents had checked in their two kids and sent them into the playroom, and there were a couple of other kids in the small play area that we had. These children had chickenpox, and reception desks are high. That's for safety reasons for the receptionist. And no one had looked down to see the child, and the parents hadn't declared that these children were spotty until another parent came up horrified. And then we had to look at separating them, closing the kids' room, disinfecting. So making sure that you have a system in place where patients are trained and you check as they're coming in regarding the potential infection. And responding quickly. So with COVID, we're recommending that, of course, that patients call ahead, that if you have access to a car park, that patients can sit in the car, or we've got, of course, remote consults, but some people will still need to come in. So triage training is for all the team, and I think that's really important in small practices. In big practices, we're in a team and everybody's job is important, and so making sure that we have those scripts that we talked about for routine questions to ask all patients. Questions about signs and symptoms. Questions for when, you know, when you're aware or you're suspecting there's a disease outbreak. And questions for when you are part of a public health response or a cluster or a pandemic. And it's also a good idea to have a central coordination point for your practice for information. And as you all know, we've kind of been bombarded with information newsletters from public health newsletters, from the PHN newsletters, from the government newsletters, from all of our PEC bodies. So making sure that there's someone in the practice that's coordinating messages, and making sure that everyone in the practice knows there's those messages. The front desk staff might not get those communications, but there'll be important information in there. So making sure that everyone is in the loop, that it's something that's discussed at team meetings, and that team members can express concerns or ask questions about how things might be managed better. So this is just a kind of example for someone coming in triaging when they might have an infectious disease, infectious condition. So telephone calls to screen all patients, getting them to call ahead if possible. Getting anyone, you know, asking the questions when we come in, we're all getting used to that now. Do you have a runny nose? Do you have a cough? Have you been near someone with COVID? Flu season is coming. Those questions will be important again. And to reinforce this with your patients and your team, that this is a normal part of modern day practice. Isolating patients into a single room if needed, or asking them to wait outside or in their car close to the practice. Making sure if they are waiting outside, you've got their phone number, they've got their easy access for you to contact them, or the doctor or the nurse going out to the car. If they're in a waiting room, making sure everyone, of course, is socially distanced. And making sure when someone's been in and out that you've wiped down after they've been in, and making sure that that's part of normal practice. When I was in Broken Hill last year, I went to do some surge workforce support, and I was working in a big vaccination clinic, and we had a patient made it all the way into me to get his vaccine. And this young man had made it through the check at the front door of the practice. So we had someone who was checking, someone who asked you questions about how you are, us filling in the form, sitting in a waiting area where they were escorted then by a health professional to me to get the vaccine. And when I saw this young man, I could tell he wasn't well, and he was breathing a bit quickly, and I took his pulse, and I could tell just by touching his wrist he had a fever. And when I did his obs, he had a temperature of 40, had a pulse of 120, and his breathing was, you know, in its mid-30s. And there was a COVID outbreak in town. And there was the potential for this person to have made it all the way into me. Fortunately, I was in full PPE for the clinic. But he had made it through many steps to get in. Unless the team was in full PPE, that could have been, if that person was positive, shut that clinic down and isolate, having all the team having to isolate. So it's really important that you catch people coming in to ask the questions. Fortunately, he wasn't COVID positive. He had pneumonia, but he had made it that far. So that triage, that initial question is really, really important. So essentials, what are the really important things for clinical governance and triage? Take-home messages are staff training. Really, really important for emergencies, urgent conditions, calling in, people wanting advice, infection control, building that into your orientation program. Making sure everyone in the practice has CPR training. And, of course, it's very good for the admin staff to do CPR and first aid, and that's very, very accessible now. There are lots of training places that offer that. An annual refresher and signing off as a log for staff of CPD. Accreditors often, I'm on a committee that looks at accrediting accreditors, and one of the things they look at is the lack of training logs for administration staff. It's really important they're part of the team, that you can prove that you've trained them, and that they have signed off that they have had the training. Strong policies and procedures in place, the triage flowcharts, and, of course, scripts for helping to manage an emergency. So I will leave that there. There's the last slide that will come through some of the resources that I've used. I always recommend that every team member has done the hand hygiene course and is refreshed regularly. It's very good for admin staff. It talks about not just washing hands, but managing that infectious contact, managing flu. So very important. The COVID-19 modules short modules, I think they're probably taken about an hour to do, around infection control for non-clinical staff. And again, all of those things can be logged in your staff CPD record. Hand hygiene posters, we printed them out in one of the practices I worked in and laminated them and stuck them all up on the wall in the reception area. And the patients were really, really impressed that our team had gone to that trouble to actually have done that and show up, I think. So, yeah, adding all of those things, staff training, really important. And there are lots of, to encourage your staff to do additional training in CPD. Thank you, Evelina.
I still encourage everybody to post some questions. And while we're waiting for them, I do have some questions. Sometimes when I'm going to the medical practice and before accreditation, I'm briefing a receptionist about the triage process. The receptionist will be often very puzzled with chest pain, call 000. They are scared to do it without consulting first with the GP. What would be your advice on it? It's a tricky question, I know.
It is a tricky question. And I suppose it depends how quickly you can access the GP. Often it will depend on whether you know the patient or not. If it's someone that you don't know and they're calling saying, I've got chest pain, then it's definitely call the ambulance. Mostly the calls from the team will put through to a clinician who will just say, call the ambulance. But I think if you're there alone, sometimes, you know, with the clinicians are out on house calls or you're there alone, it's call the ambulance. So I think not to be scared of it and to make sure that that's discussed at a staff meeting, that's okay to do and it's built into your protocols.
Mm. When I worked in the medical practice, it always scared me so much to call the ambulance. So it's good to go with practice nurse or doctor through all these questions they're going to ask, because I know that I was panicking when I was calling ambulance in the reception. So it's good to be prepared for it as well. Now we are in the time of the telehealth. So it's very tricky to triage sometimes if someone calls. Any tips on that maybe?
Yeah, look, I think that comes back to having a set of questions to ask if you're at the front desk and you're not trained in making clinical assessments. I think the same request for telehealth, you know, for a very urgent thing is a trigger to put that through to a clinician if you're not sure of how quickly to get them in, and to make sure you have documented somewhere that you've put them through, or whether it be just in a message bubble that you formally documented that person has called. Very important for mental health emergencies. I've had people call, you know, who are threatening self-harm or in distressed condition. So making sure that you have documented where they are, who they are, where they are, and whether you need to get them in immediately, it's worth saying, I'll just check with the doctor, I'll just check with the nurse. But yeah, to make sure that you have a process in place to support staff who need to make those quick decisions.
I think also when COVID approached and we are spacing our patients out, sometimes it's very difficult to monitor, multiply waiting areas, because sometimes patients waiting outside of the practice. Would you suggest a receptionist to go out from time to time to just check?
If you're concerned about them, yes. if you're concerned about them, probably you should have them somewhere, hopefully you can see them, but to make sure that they've got a phone and you've got immediate contact with them on the phone is also, you know, an alternative.
Sure, we have for sure a lot of new starters on our webinar. Any questions, please put them to question and answers. And if we will not have any questions, remember that when we finish the session, there will be evaluation form. Please fill it up so you can get your certificate. Together with your certificate, you will get the triage poster. You can print it out, laminate it, and put it in the reception area for the girls to just check, or boys just to check in case they are panicking like me in emergency situations.
I think another point with the flowchart in particular is the accreditors will look for that as well. Sure. So, you know, part of their job is assessing quality and safety, and having that very easily viewed by the reception team, quality and safety mechanism for your practice, and they will check that you're across that.
Okay, I have another question. With the flu season coming up, what is your advice for triage and COVID as the symptoms are very similar?
I think you treat everything as infectious. And so whether it's influenza or COVID, you can't tell. You can't tell unless you've had a PCR. And that may take 24, 48 hours. So you treat them as infectious. The advice will be similar, and the risks for some population members will be similar. You know, they have if you're elderly, high risk of needing to go to hospital, running, or children. But certainly running your immunisation clinics spaced out, which COVID is still here, so we'll all have to run the same. And the ATAGI has an HHCCC, whatever the letters are now, have approved COVID and flu vaccines can be given at the same time. So you might find that you have a situation where you are giving flu and COVID vaccines. We're still part the way, the booster program is only part the way through for adults. Nationally, the children's program is, you know, under 50% have had one dose. So that's got a way to go yet. So we can expect, I think, a lot of vaccine traffic through our practices. Flu season is coming. So I think, yeah, we'll need to logistically think about how we manage that and the flow through so that people aren't sitting around for too long in close contact.
Sure. Another question. What can we do to minimize patients' waiting time? Some GPs are always running late for their appointments. Is there any things we can put into place?
The person that can answer that question, I think, will make a lot of money. But, you know, on the day, people come to the practice and they may have problems that are much more urgent than they thought, and the doctor runs behind. If you plan ahead, if you realise that your doctor is maybe running an hour behind, it's worth checking with the doctor to say, look, or, you know, half an hour behind, do you want me to call the next patient to say, come a little bit later? Sometimes the GPs will catch up. Sometimes they'll have a day, particularly where the GPs who have high chronic disease workloads may run late. So it's worthwhile checking. Is it okay to call the patient and say, delay coming for 15 minutes, just so you don't have quite so many people in the waiting room?
So planning ahead and leaving some space for the GPs to catch up is always good with that, with the appointments. But not all GPs will let us to do it. I have another question. For patients with gastro symptoms, do we let them into the waiting room area or isolate them in the room or wait for doctor call?
So if they turn up, they need to be isolated. Gastro is spread by droplet infection. So coughing, A lot of diseases are spread by droplet infection, and people touch their mouths and then they touch the seat or they touch the door handle. So ideally, if they have anything infectious, they need to be isolated. And preferably, thankfully, with telehealth, a lot of patients with gastro symptoms can probably have a telehealth consultation. They can get advice from the GP or the nurse about hydration and fluid management and symptom management, particularly with children. And then certainly telehealth would be the much better option. And looking at advice. Now, things aren't getting better, or if your child stops wetting their nappy, this is the time to go to hospital. So making sure that they do get some sort of clinical advice, but definitely try and keep them out of the practice.
What would happen when Medicare ends telehealth and we have patients with COVID flu symptoms? They have been allowed in the practice while telehealth, they haven't been allowed in the practice while telehealth has been around, but what about when it ends?
I think you have to go back to what is my risk management strategy. If someone infectious comes into the practice and then half of my team is close contact, what happens next? What happens if my team gets sick? What happens if I have to close my business? So looking at, I think that telehealth will be extended. I think we'll go past, it was extended to the middle of the year, but I think that given the numbers in New South Wales, I think yesterday were up 1,000 on the day before. So I think it'll be a hard call to stop the COVID telehealth. There will be, I think, remain access to telehealth, and certainly some of the health reforms coming through tie telehealth to GP practices and possible patient registration that they're talking about later in the year. So I think telehealth will remain. It's certainly wise to keep someone infectious out of the practice to reduce risk to your business and risk to patients in the waiting room.
And another one, what do you recommend doing if patient strongly refuses the ambulance call despite explaining the risk and the situation? Is there a duty of care?
That's a very good question. And the answer is to a degree, yes. So you would make sure absolutely that you documented that, and you can still make the decision to call the ambulance. And if they refuse once the ambulance gets there, then that's their, pardon me, you know, their immediate decision. But I think that you can offer, if someone was at home with chest pain and said, I don't want to go in the ambulance, I think the sense of urgency and patient protection would be to call the ambulance. So, but I'd absolutely make sure that everything is documented.
Thank you. That's it. Thank you very much.
Excellent.
So everybody, have a nice evening and see you on the next event. Thank you.